I'm a firm believer of leveraging technology to improve productivity, and using genetic algorithms to generate trading strategies has been a real game changer for me. If you have never heard of genetic evolution, or you are new to trading in general, you are probably skeptical about the process. So in this video, I'll explain the concepts behind genetic evolution, how genetic algorithms can benefit you, and go through step by step how you can use StrategyQuant's genetic algorithm to automatically generate profitable trading strategies.
Inspired by Darwin's theory of evolution, genetic algorithms mimic the biological processes of natural selection, reproduction, and mutation to create increasingly profitable strategies. Like humans, populations of strategies evolve and progressively improve across generations. Before explaining the process, here are some essential definitions. These terms are analogous to those used in biology. Population refers to a local pool of strategies you currently have, much like the residents of a city. To kickstart the evolution process, an initial population is randomly generated using the input information. Generation collectively refers to the entire strategy population at one point in time. Successive generations are produced as evolution progresses. Islands refer to separated populations of strategies, each of which evolves simultaneously and independently. Think of two geographically isolated cities whose residents evolve independently. Research shows that such a parallel approach usually improves efficiency of the evolution. The product of each island's population size and the number of islands gives you the total number of strategies managed by the algorithm. Occasionally, strategies can migrate from island to island, improving diversity across the populations and delaying fitness stagnation. Next are the closely related concepts of fitness, crossover, and selection. Fitness refers to how well the strategy meets your performance expectations. Fitness functions are used to quantify fitness. Net profit is a simple example. Crossover is the combination of two parent strategies from the current generation to create a new strategy for the next generation. Selection is the process of giving fitter strategies a higher probability of crossing over and forming subsequent generations. It is through repeated selections and crossovers that strategies progressively improve through the generations. And finally, mutation is the random replacement of a strategy's elements with another from the input pool. A low mutation rate can be beneficial because it increases diversity in your strategy population. The specifics of each genetic algorithm will vary, but here's the general outline of the process. Let's briefly go through each step. First, we specify our inputs, such as the indicators and types of trade entries and exits used. I'll illustrate this with a trend-following strategy later. These inputs are then randomly combined to form the initial population. Fitness is computed for each strategy in the population, and fitter strategies are assigned higher probabilities of being used for crossovers. During each crossover, the two parent strategies are split at a randomly determined point and the resulting building blocks are spliced together to create a child strategy. This child subsequently replaces one of the parent strategies. The final operation in each evolution cycle is mutation, where one of the strategy's building blocks is randomly replaced by another from the input pool. After crossover and mutation are complete, the next generation of strategies is created. The processes of selection, crossover, and mutation are repeated until the evolution is stopped, thus progressively creating fitter strategies. Note that genetic algorithms operate based on probabilities. Like human evolution, there is no guarantee that the next generation of strategies will be fitter than the current one. However, over the course of evolution spanning multiple generations, strategy fitness is very likely to improve. Later on, I'll show you how to restart the genetic algorithm if fitness stagnates. In exchange for the complicated process, do you get any benefits in return? Think about the various elements of your strategy and how many possibilities exist for each of them. What indicator should you use for your entry? What look-back period is optimal? It quickly becomes evident that there are infinite ways to build a strategy. Genetic algorithms iterate through millions of strategies and help discover optimal combinations of strategy elements or indicators that you may never have thought of. Genetic algorithms are intelligent and computationally efficient. Through repeated selection, crossover, and mutation, they quickly shrink the search space by removing unprofitable strategy elements. Not only do you generate profitable strategies quickly, you also get a better understanding of which elements or indicators work best. And most importantly, they are fully automatic. Once you have set up your input conditions, simply press start and profitable strategies will fill up your databank. I'll illustrate the entire process by creating a trend-following strategy for the 1-hour pound yen. Now let's dissect StrategyQuant's generation process, starting with the genetic algorithm explained previously. Before running the algorithm, we first set up our desired strategy elements, backtest data, and evolution settings. The generated strategies are passed through the performance filters specified during setup. If they pass, they will be saved into a databank. The genetic algorithm runs until you manually stop it or until a specific constraint is reached, such as the time elapsed or number of strategies generated. Time to set up StrategyQuant's genetic algorithm, starting with building blocks. This is where you select your strategy's entry and exit types and the technical indicators used for them. The pound yen is a volatile market with some awesome trends, although frequent whipsaws and false breakouts should be expected. I'll try to minimize false entries by using stop entries, where the entry price is above the current price for longs and below it for shorts. Some market confirmation is thus required before the entry occurs. There are numerous options for the exit types. I personally consider stop losses to be mandatory for risk control. For simplicity, I'll select only the stop loss and bar base time stop. For subsequent builds, I recommend experimenting with different entry and exit types depending on the type of strategy you wish to build and the market you will trade it on. Profit targets tend to work better for short-term countertrend strategies, while trailing stops work well for long-term trend following strategies. Now for the technical indicators. StrategyQuant comes loaded with a whole bunch of indicators. If these aren't enough, you can program and import your own custom indicators or download the additional indicator packages released every few months. I prefer sticking to traditional indicators such as Bollinger Bands, CCI, and moving averages. These have stood the test of time because they work. Different indicators simply capture different parts of the same trend. Next up are the indicators' parameter ranges. All look-back periods will be within the 10 to 100 range. Since the genetic algorithm will be running countless iterations with different combinations of building blocks, your selective ranges should be large enough to accommodate a variety of market conditions and strategy types. To minimize the risk of overfitting, I will have no more than 2 entry conditions. I will experiment with both PIP and ATR-based stop losses across a similarly large range of values. For money management, I prefer to use a fixed lot size during strategy development. Consider these 2 equity curves. Both are identical strategies with $3,000 initial capital. The first strategy traded a fixed 0.1 lots throughout, producing a $6,100 profit. The second strategy traded 0.1 lots for every $3,000 of account balance, meaning position sizes increased as the account grew, eventually producing $18,600 profit. This tripling of profits was purely due to position sizing. By removing position sizing during development, you get a clearer picture of the strategy's consistency over the back test. I will use a micro lot size, which is usually the smallest increment you can trade. If you wish to develop strategies with variable position sizing, the very popular fixed fractional method is also available. Once you start trading live, you should implement some form of variable sizing to amplify your strategy's edge. Moving on to the data tab, I'll select pound yen data from 2003 to 2020. The settings here are similar to what you get in MT4, except that you can separately factor in slippage and commissions. If you mainly use market orders, it's prudent to add in a conservative slippage. Your commissions, if any, can be obtained from your broker. The selected timeframe only test precision is similar to MT4's open prices only model. For trend following on the higher timeframes, this should suffice. One of my favorite features is the ability to run out of sample tests during strategy generation itself. This crucial robustness test helps estimate how well your strategy will perform in live trading. To take advantage of this inbuilt robustness test, you will need to partition your data into in-sample and out-of-sample portions. Only the in-sample portion will be used for strategy generation. Ideally, both data segments should be long enough to cover different market conditions and produce a decent sample size. For simplicity, I'll just use a 50-50 data split. 8 years of data should be sufficient for each portion. Later on, I will set up performance filters to select only strategies with good out-of-sample performance. Next, we have the genetic algorithm settings. There is little consensus across the scientific literature as to what settings are optimal, possibly because these settings are application-dependent. Nonetheless, I find the default StrategyQuant settings to work well. The recommended population size is 10 to 100. A population that is too small provides little diversity and leaves little room for improvement, while an excessively large one causes long computation times. Remember the islands we discussed earlier? Let's start with 5 islands with a population of 50 strategies each. Occasional cross-island migration can occur, helping to rejuvenate some strategies whose fitness may have reached a plateau. You don't want excessive migration though, otherwise you will lose the diversity across the independent islands. Crossover probability refers to the probability that each strategy will be used for crossover. A probability of 1 means the subsequent generation of strategies will be created entirely from crossovers of the current strategies. In the literature, values of 0.5 to 0.9 are commonly used. Mutation probability is the likelihood that a randomly selected element from each strategy will be swapped with another element from the pool of building blocks. A low mutation probability is beneficial because it adds diversity. If it is too high, it will negate the effects of selection and crossover, making the evolution essentially random. Let's hop over to the ranking tab for a bit, where we can deselect our fitness function. The return over drawdown ratio is a simple risk-adjusted performance metric that should suffice. You also have the option of creating a custom-weighted fitness function consisting of numerous metrics. The main data backtest option means that only your strategy's performance on the pound yen will be used to compute fitness. An alternative is to compute fitness over an entire portfolio of markets, or even using the strategy's Monte Carlo performance. These are great ways to build robust strategies, but computation time will rise significantly. Now let's discuss evolution management, where you determine when to stop or restart the evolution. I will run the algorithm for 6 hours. An alternative is to stop the algorithm once a target number of strategies has been generated. Going back to the genetic tab, I usually let the entire evolution process repeat itself after the maximum of 50 generations has been reached. Another initial population will be randomly generated when the evolution restarts. Remember that genetic algorithms operate based on probabilities? There is a small chance that the strategies get weaker as they evolve. If this happens, you have the option of restarting the evolution if population fitness stagnates over a set number of generations. And finally, don't forget your performance filters. Since the genetic algorithm will be generating hundreds of strategies per minute, these filters are needed to separate the boys from the men. It is inevitable that certain combinations of building blocks will not produce viable strategies. To counter this, StrategyQuant comes with a slew of automatic filters. Custom filters allow you to set your own performance benchmarks for the build. To screen for consistency over the backtest period, you can specify performance filters for each data segment. For this case, the 16-year data period was equally split into in and out of sample segments, so I have specified filters for each 8-year period. Firstly, I want a decent sample size, so I'll look for at least 300 trades over the entire backtest period, which translates to about 1.5 trades per month. A 1.3 profit factor over each period is about the minimum profitability I can accept. I usually add in an expectancy filter to make sure transaction costs can be covered. With a 0.01 lot size, the 50 cents specified here translates to about 5 pips. In addition, with the array of economic reports that are periodically released, I do not wish to hold my trades for longer than 30 days, so let me limit the trade duration. That's it for the setup. Click start and watch the algorithm do its thing. Here are the build statistics after 6 hours. The genetic algorithm iterated through 400,000 strategies, of which 99% failed our performance filters. Lack of profitability is usually the most common reason for failure. There are about 2,400 strategies in the databank. Here's the statistics for one of them. The out-of-sample performance is marginally weaker, but still acceptable. So there you have it. That's how you harness the efficiency of genetic evolution to automatically generate profitable strategies. So what's next? Before going live, I recommend running your strategies through robustness tests such as walk-forward optimizations and Monte Carlo simulations. The videos on the right will show you the way. Remember to like, comment, and subscribe, and happy trading!